For our last hymn, if you would open to number 464 if you need it. Excuse me, 464, How Firm a Foundation. We'll sing the first, the second, and the last verse. If you would stand with me as we sing. Of the next verse. So we're going to sing that again as the beginning of the second verse. Here we go.
Fear not, I am with thee. Oh, be not dismayed, for I am thy God and will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand upheld by my gracious omnipotent hand. The soul that on Jesus doth lean for repose, I will not desert to his foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake,
before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands. My name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair, and tells me of my guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness. The great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, My soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God.
All right, Josh, you can put that back up on this one, if you would, please. I want to review with you some things we talked about 2 weeks ago, or last week as well. Turn over to 1 Peter chapter 4, and this is where we are picking up. And we've got three sermons left. Today I'm going to talk to you about the talent, stewardship of your talent, and we'll look at that in just a minute. But I want to have you glance with me at the review of a couple things. We asked the question that Jesus asked, and that was in Luke chapter 12 and verse 42. Now, remember, the Lord Jesus Christ, we understand from the Scriptures that he is the Son of God. He is the one that came to the earth representing God in the flesh. We can't see God. We don't know God in the sense of being able to touch him, to be able to feel him. But when Jesus came, he was the physical incarnation of God himself, and that's who Jesus was. When he walked on the earth, he was God in physical form. That's who Jesus was. And as Jesus was teaching, he asked this question in Luke 12, 42. Who then is that faithful and wise steward? So that was important. We talked about that last time. And then we said the word steward is the really two words put together in the Greek language. It means a house manager, one who owns nothing but has complete authority over another's possessions, we said, and has complete responsibility for another's things. So this person who is a steward, they don't have anything, but they basically are running the show for someone else. I think for those of you that have ever seen Lord of the Rings before, that movie, that series, you know the steward of the Great White City. Maybe you heard that before, and how that guy was not the king, but he was the steward. He ran the show because he wasn't actually the lineage of the king. That was a steward. It helps you put it in your mind, more or less, what a steward does. He has complete authority, complete responsibility of his success and the failure of the things that he is working for, but he doesn't own it, and that is a steward. So we looked at this, and we said Psalm 24:1 says that God owns everything. God owns everything. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. God owns everything. Say that with me. God owns everything. God owns everything. He owns everything that you have. You own nothing. Everything that you think you own, remember again, God gave that to you. Even the ability to make money. Deuteronomy says he gives you the power to make wealth. See, you don't even have any ability on your own. It's all God's doing. God owns it all. So we looked at this about stewardship last time. He has given us complete authority, though, over the possessions in our life. Everything that we own, everything that we think that is ours, everything that we have in our hands, every commodity that we have is something that God's given to us. And he says, I'm giving you complete authority. As a steward, we manage everything that God has given to us. So that's everything, not just money. We tend to think stewardship about money, but it's more than just money. It's your time. And so last time we talked about the issue of time, and this is our verse. We look at it up here. It's the same verse there, but I broke it down. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same gift as good stewards. It is the manifold grace of God given to us to manage his gifts that are given to us. And so we're learning about stewardship, aren't we? A lot of neat things there. So last week we were told about time, managing our time. And not sure if you've learned much about that. I hope that you have. You grasp a hold of that. But when you understand that every moment that you live has been given to you by the grace of God, and he can take it when he wants, but he's given it to you and says, listen, I've given you birth. I've given you a life. Now manage it for me. That's what he wants. Now, he is the Lord of time. We saw that last time. We mentioned as far as time is concerned, he is the one that is the creator of time. We said in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The idea of a beginning is the basis of time, isn't it? In the beginning, that's time, God created the heavens and the earth. We have time, space, and matter, all of our existence in one verse. In the beginning, that's time, God created the heaven, that's space, and the earth, that is the physical part of it. Time, space, and matter, all three of those things right there. So he is the Lord of time, we saw that, and he is the one that gave us time. We saw this last week. A length of this time has been appointed to us. Now, some of you, you've been alive for a very long time, 80 plus years. Last week, we actually, when I was talking about this, we had Dalton's grandmother here, a great-grandmother, 90 years old that was here, 90 years old. God gave that woman 90 years so far. Some of you, he's given 20 years. Some of you, have given 18 years. That's God giving to you a length of time. He created time. He's given you a period of time. And that time will one day run out. Every one of us, we know that. Death is coming, right? How many believe that one day you're going to die? Say amen. Raise your hand. You know that. You're going to die. And you shouldn't fear death because death is not the end. By the way, death really only simply means separation is what the word death means. You are separated. Your soul will be separated from your physical body. So in death, your appointed time is going to come to a time of separation where your body will finally cease to exist. You will turn back into dust, but your soul will go on forever, forever and ever. And so you know that you will exist somewhere forever, either with God in eternity in heaven, or because of our sin, we will face the penalty of eternal damnation. We've talked about that before. So the length of this time has been appointed to us, so we have a stewardship. The lesson on time, we said, what do we need to do then, Pastor? What should I be doing? Redeem the time. And the idea of redeeming means to seize the opportunity, to seize opportunities as they come by, the opportunity for one of salvation. You know, it's amazing. Not everybody, if you think about it, there are some people in this world who have never heard of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Did you know that? They've never heard that Jesus died on the cross for them. How many understand what I'm saying? Raise your hand. You know, Brother Valbuena, who was just here and talking about the Philippines, we know that in the Philippines, the gospel is being preached, but there are people on some of those islands who have never heard the gospel. There are people all around the world who've never heard the gospel. But guess what? You did. You heard the gospel maybe once or twice, because in America or in other countries where it's very westernized in the sense of you've got technology, you've got a cell phone, a smartphone, and you have access to the internet, you've heard the gospel many, many times. Most people have on the earth that have technology, they've heard the gospel in some fashion or form. Maybe it was in a book or a sermon or a radio broadcast or a friend. And you hear the gospel, and Jesus says, listen, I've given you time. I've given you a birth date when you were born. You have a time, and you're going to die one day. Now, in the middle of all of this, you need to redeem the time. You need to seize the opportunity. When you hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, you need to seize that opportunity and trust Jesus as your Savior. Can I get an amen? And most of you have done that. You've trusted Christ as your Savior and how important that was. Then once you trust Christ as your Savior, now you are living your life to its end that God has appointed for you. And he says, you continue seizing the time. Continue managing your time for me. And that's why it's so important that we have good stewardship of our time. So we looked at that last time. Now, again, quickly, we added a new verse. The new verse that we already read, now take a look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 11. You've turned there. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. So look at the slide. If any man speak or minister, he says, let him do it as of the ability that God gives. Everybody say the word ability. That's the same idea as a talent. See up here? We're talking about stewardship, managing God's gifts to us of our time and our talent. Talent is ability. It is the ability that God gives to everybody. We all have that ability. Why? That God in all things might be glorified through Jesus Christ. And so I want to leave this question up here. Who then is the faithful and wise steward as we go through the message? So you've already read verse 11, but let's go back to verse 10, 1 Peter. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same, the gift, one to another as good stewards of the manifold, the many-faceted grace of God. God gives so many gifts, time, talent, treasures. If any man speak, then he goes on, let him speak as the oracles of God, as though that was the very word of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability that God giveth, that God in all things might be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. This morning, I'm going to talk to you about the stewardship of talent. Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you for already speaking to our hearts through the words of the music, for the testimony of the Valbuena family in the Philippines. We pray that you bless them. And Lord, now as we, as friends, are sitting here hearing the word of God and hearing these words, we pray that you'd help us to understand what you require of us as you have given us so many things. You've given us time, but Lord, you've also given us talent. Help us understand how to be good stewards of our talent. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, what is talent? Now, in Britain, they have a show called Britain's Got Talent. In America, we have a show called what? America Has Talent, right? So I don't know if you've ever seen any of that. I've seen a couple episodes or at least glimpses of that. And it's interesting. I wonder to myself, is that really talent? What is talent? You know what the dictionary basically says, that talent is an aptitude or a facility, a gift, a knack, a technique, a touch, a bent, an ability. It's the ability to do something. It's a talent that you have, and every one of us have talent. Now, it's interesting. There are some who have much more ability than others. If you know what a child prodigy is, raise your hand if you know what a child prodigy is. The strict definition of a child prodigy is someone that's 10 years of age or younger that has the talent or ability that far surpasses even an adult. So it's called a child prodigy. Let me give you a couple of examples. How many have ever heard of Mozart before, the composer? Now, Mozart, at 4 years of age, how old? Four. At 4 years of age, was playing a harpsichord, similar to a piano back in those days. At 4 years of age, he played it so well that people came to hear him. At 5 years of age, Mozart was composing music on the harpsichord. How old? At five. At 7 years of age, he was traveling with his family, and people came and paid to hear him play at seven. That was Mozart. There's a guy by the name of John Van Neumann. At 6 years of age, he was able to speak classical Greek. He was a mathematician. He was unbelievably talented with the ability to memorize mathematical equations, but also numbers. He memorized the phone book. And as people would come through, they would basically give the name, their name, and he would say, I could tell you not only your name, but everybody else's name on that page. And he memorized phone books, this guy, John von Neumann, at 6 years of age, classical Greek speaker. There was a guy by the name of William Sidis. Now, let me give you a thought here. Do you know what your IQ is? A normal person's IQ is between 85 and 115. Okay, so what's your IQ? 85? 115? That's a normal person. A genius IQ is 136. That's your normal genius is 136. This guy, William Sidis, his IQ was 250 to 300. This man was an incredible man. At 18 months of age, he was already reading. At seven, he had already written four books, and he was, at seven, fluent in eight languages. At seven. IQ of 250 to 300. He was lecturing in Harvard at nine, and he entered Harvard as a student at 11. Isn't that crazy? Talent, ability, where does it come from? I think about this other guy. Have you heard of the child doctor? Was it Doogie Howser? They made a program about him a long time ago. There's a real person, though, by the name of Akrit Jaswal. Akrit Jaswal is a young man in India. At 7 years of age, he was operating as a child surgeon in India. And he knew what he was doing at seven. See, guys, I give that to you because we see stuff like this and we hear these child prodigies and these great abilities and we say, man, how did that happen? Did it just somehow evolve that this kid was able to do these things? Well, some people think that, but we know better than that, that wherever there is a design or there's intelligence, there has to be someone who gave that intelligence to that person, who gave that ability to that person. Now, all of us here, we may not have an IQ of 250 to 300. For heaven's sake, we may not even have an IQ of 85, right? We're struggling just to do anything. But everybody here has an ability. Everyone here has a talent. Did you know that? I don't know what it is for you, but you know, it's amazing when you see the scriptures, God really doesn't spend a lot of time talking about our outward ability. He doesn't talk about much about our face or our body or how we look. Although we spend a lot of time and money on that, he really doesn't talk about that at all. He talks about you as a person, who you are, how you are made, and what he has done. And right now, you may not look the best. You may not be the weight you want to be or have the right kind of hair color that you want to be. But understand this, God gave you talent. God gave you something that only you have. You have an ability to do something. Now, what is that? We're going to talk about that in just a minute. Every single person here is valuable in the eyes of God. You have an ability, you have a talent that someone else doesn't have, or maybe someone does. Maybe they can do it better than you. Maybe you do something better than somebody else, but everybody has an ability. Everybody has a talent that God has given. Now, some child prodigies, God has given a great amount of talent and ability. Others, he's given just a normal ability and a talent. I'm going to show you that that all comes from God. It's a very powerful thing that we see in the scriptures. So let's talk about that, this stewardship of talent. The first thing I want you to see is the source of our talent, the source of all talent. Take a look back at verse 11 again of 1 Peter. He says, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth. Everybody say, God gives the ability. God did that. God gives everyone the abilities that they have. You know what the word ability is? The word ability is the word iscus, is the old language word that means strength or forcefulness. You have the ability. You have the strength. Mark chapter 12, verse 30. Listen to this verse. It uses that same word. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind and with all thy strength. Everybody say strength. Strength. That's ability. With all your strength, with all your ability. This is the first commandment. And by the way, for every now, I don't care if you are a born-again believer or if you're an atheist. God commands every single person to love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, all of your ability. Whether you believe in him or not, he says you need to love me with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength because I made you, I created you, and you are accountable to me. And so love me with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Listen to another verse. This is Ephesians 1:19. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe? According to the working of his mighty power. Everybody say mighty power. Mighty power. The ability. Ephesians 6:10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Say power of his might. That is the word ability. He says, to be strong, you be strong in the power of the ability that I have given to you. My mighty power is the ability that I have given to you. God has a strength, he has a force, and he has a power that he has given to you as a person. Just the very fact that you're standing here and you can read. How many can read? Raise your hand. How many don't read? No, don't raise your hand then. But you can read. The reason why you can read and understand phonetics and be able to read language, that kind of thing, is because God gave you the ability to do it. You know, a dog cannot read. Animals can't do things that man has done. God has given you as a person the ability to read. How many play music? Raise your hand. Did you know some people have no clue about music? They can't play music. They can't sing music. They can't carry a tune. God has given some of you that ability to do that. Others, you don't have that ability to do that. How many are really good at math? Raise your hand. You're really good at math. My goodness, God bless you. But you know what? I don't have that ability. I can do some math, but I know some. My wife's that way. She can look at the algebraic equations, and she's just got it down. I know, and then there's others even smarter than her. They just have math. Her father, my father-in-law, is super good at math, science. That ability to learn and to be able to comprehend that, God has given everyone the ability, but to some, he's given a little more ability, and I'm going to show you that. That's all from God. He is the one that gives us the abilities that we have. Now, turn over to Matthew chapter 25, and I'm going to give you a different take on a familiar parable. Now, Matthew 25 is the parable of the five talents. Now, you know this parable very well. In chapter 25, Matthew, verse 14 says, "For the kingdom of heaven," verse 14, "is as a man traveling into a far country who called his own servants, and he delivered unto them his goods." Now here's stewardship. The man is leaving. He calls his stewards, his servants, and he says, "Take care of my stuff." That's what the steward does. "Take care of my stuff." And he looks at each steward, and he says, "I'm going to give you 5 talents. He looked at another and said, "I'm going to give you 3. And he looked at one other and he said, "I'm going to give you 1. Read the story. "And he gave 5 talents, to verse 15. He gave 5 talents to another, 2, and to another, 1. To every man or steward according to his several," and what's the next word? "Ability." Huh. What is ability? Strength, power. Where does it come from? God. "To his several ability, and straightway he took his journey." It's interesting. We always talk about the talents and serving God and using your talents. But you see that verse right there tells us that when God gave, or the homeowner was giving out the talents, he looked at each person according to their individual ability. He said, "You, come here. I'm giving you 5 because I know you have the ability to handle 5. You, come here. I'm going to give you 2 because I know you have the ability to successfully manage 2. And you, come here. I'm going to give you 1 because you really struggle. I'm going to just give you 1. Just do what you can with that one." See, the man that owned these stewards and all of his goods, he knew the abilities of each person. So you got to understand that. That God, as he gives out the abilities, as he gives to every man these abilities, he's given to some the ability to do really great things. Others, not as much of ability. Others, just barely any ability. God does that. He's the one that does that. But guess what? He expects, no matter what your ability is, to do something with it. For those of you that have the ability to take 5 talents and double it to 5 more, which that guy did, well done, thou good and faithful servant steward. The one that took the 2 and doubled it, well done. The one that took the 1 and didn't do anything with the ability that he had, I only just had the 1, but he didn't use his ability. He was the one that was judged. He was the one that was disgraced and ashamed. Everybody gets ability from God, but on different levels. We understand that. Not everybody has the same. You're not a William Sidis who has an IQ of 300, for heaven's sake, and then at 7 years of age mastered 8 languages. You're not a Mozart that at 4 could play and compose music at 5. You're not that way. I get it. But you are a person that God has given ability to. And he wants you to manage that ability. Listen to what Gordon says. We have nothing to do with how much ability we've got or how little, but with what we do with what we have. The man with great talent is apt to be puffed up. The man with little talent to belittle the little he has. Poor fools, God gives it much or little. Our part is to be faithful, doing the level best with every bit and scrap, and we will be if Jesus' Spirit controls us. Henry Van Dyke said this, use what talents you possess. The woods would be very silent if no birds sang there except those that sang best. I like that. So sing. Use your talent for God. Well, I don't have what they've got. Who cares? They're responsible to use their talent for God, and they better use the ability that they have. You may not have that talent. Use what you have. God gave you certain things. Are you managing stewardship of the talent God has given to you? Well, I know. Then you're the one that's accountable to God for the lack of use of your talent, no matter how big or small it is. Those of you that have great talent and are not using it, guess what? You are also accountable to God. God gives the talent. He is the source of it all. I think of David in wonderful passage of scripture, and you can turn over there. Look at Psalm 18, if you'll go to the Old Testament. David was a tremendous man of God. Someone tell me if you can remember some things that David did. Someone just yell out, what did David, King David, do? What was important about David? Someone yell something out. Yeah, everybody says that. He defeated Goliath. And by the way, how old was David when he killed Goliath? He was probably about 16, 17 years of age. He wasn't, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger walking around killing Goliath. He was a little kid. He was a teenage boy, right? What else did David do? He played music. He played the harp. He was able such a way to play the harp that he calmed the evil spirit that was upon Saul. Quite a talent, wasn't it? What else did David do? Yeah. He was a great warrior. Not only was he a great warrior, he was a great strategist. Did you know David never lost a battle? Conquered everything. Amazing. Great strategist. What else did he do? He played music, but he also wrote music because Psalms, half of Psalms was written by David. That's music. What you going to say? Go ahead. He was a man of prayer. Wise. Unbelievable. All the things that we know about David. Now, I want you to see this now. Now, notice what David says in Psalms here. In chapter 18, Psalm 18, look at verse 32. Notice what he says. It is God that girdeth me with strength, ability, maketh my way perfect. Now, notice, he maketh my feet like hinds' feet. Remember when he was running from Saul in the deserts and Saul could never catch him? He setteth me upon my high places. He teacheth my hands to war. JB said he was a great warrior. He says, God taught me to war. So that a bow of steel is broken by my arms. Thou hast also given me the shield of thy salvation. Thy right hand hath holden me up. Thy gentleness hath made me great. Thou hast enlarged my steps under me that my feet simply did not slip. The guy was successful at everything. I have pursued my enemies, overtook them. Neither did I turn again till they were consumed. I always won. I have wounded them that they were not able to rise. They are fallen under my feet, he says. For thou, God, hast girded me with strength, ability under the battle. Thou hast subdued under me those that rose up against me. See, David understood that everything that I do comes from my God. My abilities, my strengths, my talent comes from God. And so I ask you the question this morning, what ability do you have? What ability do you have? What power? What might? You know, some people are good at making money. Do you know that? Wherever they go, they just make money. They just know how to do it. I wish I could do that. Don't you? I wish I could do that. I can't do that. You don't have that ability. Some people know the stock market. They know what you do as far as investing, and they know how to do this and flip houses and do real estate and do that and that. And next thing you know, they got six figures and they got $100 million and $1 billion, and they go on and on. And where do they do that? God says in Deuteronomy, I give you the power to make wealth. God is the one that gives you that ability to do that. Not everybody, remember? Some, not others. God is the one that gives out those abilities. What about music? Can you play music? God gives you the ability to hear the tones, to make the music. It's amazing to me when you see some people, they can just pick up an instrument and they can just start playing with just a very little instruction with music. They can play the piano, then they can play this and they can play that, and they just go on and on. It's like, man, how do they have that? God has done that. What about languages? Others of you can learn languages. I was talking to Nikita. How many languages he knows? He knows several languages. God gives you the ability to learn those languages. What about speaking in front of people? God gives some the ability to have oratory skills and others don't have it. Moses said to God, I can't speak. I can't speak. And then God gave him the ability to speak. Jeremiah said the same thing. I can't speak in front of this people. And then God said, I will give you the words to say. I will put my words in your mouth. God did that. Administration and business. It's amazing how some men can go into a failing business and turn that business completely around only by making a few decisions, but he knew what to do. God's ability. Look at our country, United States of America, the deficit that we were in and all the mess of our country financially, how terrible it was. And so what do? We got a businessman to go in the presidency. Is he a moral man? No. Is he a godly man? Not necessarily. Is he wise in every area? No. But the guy knows business. And he knows what to do. You cut the taxes here and you do this and get rid of these regulations here. And guess what? Economy's going to boom. And guess what? The economy boomed. God did that. God gave him that. See, understand that God is the one. What are the abilities that you have? Now, remember now, what are we talking about? Stewardship. Everybody say stewardship. Stewardship says God owns it, we do not, but he gives it to us to manage. We manage that which he gives to us, ability, power, might, strength, and our talents and our natural ability. Everything that you have this morning, yes, time is all God's, use it for him, but now talent, your ability, whatever you can do, some of you are good with computers, some of you are good with even video gaming, believe it or not, that's a talent. I don't see how it could be, but it is a talent. I understand that soldiers who go off to war, a lot of times the guys they use for soldiering and so forth, they actually give them video games to play the battle so they can be in those contexts. I get that. There's something to that. And you have that ability. Now here, God gave you that ability. Do you know that? Say amen if you're getting it. Got it? Because I'll just re-preach all these points again if you don't. So it's the source of our talent is God, which God giveth. Now, number two, the substance of our talent. The substance. Here's my question. What is the talent? What is the difference between an ability and the gifts of the Spirit? Good question. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 3, the Bible says that God gives to every believer, get this, a measure of faith. Romans 12, 3. God gives to believers a measure of faith. He doesn't give to every believer the same amount of faith. Now, we all have faith to trust Jesus Christ as our Savior. Hallelujah, because you can't unless you have faith. Now, I get it. If you don't believe in God, you don't believe in Jesus. I get that. I can understand where you might be coming from. That's why it takes faith. It takes faith to believe in God. And it's not a blind faith, a leap in the dark and hope that God's there. No, it's based upon a substance, a reality. What is the reality? Look around. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth his handiwork. Day in a day uttereth his speech. And there is no language nor voice where his speech where his voice is not heard. Meaning, look at the sky, look at creation, and you know that design demands a designer. The evidence that there is intelligence, the evidence that there is a pattern around us shows that there's something with intelligence that made all of that. And God said, look around you. I'm everywhere. So he doesn't say jump in the dark. He says believe by faith the substance that you see around you. And those that believe in evolution and all of that, it's just as much of a faith. You didn't see that take place. You don't know for sure if that happens. Amazing to me how wrong scientists are all the time anyway. And we believe, oh, because a scientist says it, it's got to be true? No way. We believe in our God. He's told us, I see around me and I see the evidences of creation all around me, and I believe that by faith. Now, once you do that, you're saved. Now, Romans 12:3 says that he gives to the believers a measure of faith. He gives you an ability. He gives you faith, and with that, we find these spiritual gifts. He gives you a listing of them. He says prophecy or ministry or teaching or exhortation, giving, ruling, mercy. In Romans 12:4 and following, 1 Corinthians 12:6, he says it's God is the one that's working in all of us to give us gifts, wisdom, the word of knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, discerning spirits, languages, interpretation of languages, helps and governments. See, as a believer, not only do I have natural inclinations that God gives me, talents, the power to do certain things, the ability naturally to do certain things, but on top of that, he gives me a measure of faith, a measure of faith to serve him in the church, to serve him in the body of Christ. Okay, that's that gift. So God has equipped every person who comes into existence with abilities. That's why you can have an unsaved person with great abilities. God did that. In a natural talent. It is he who is the source of it all. It's the ability that God gives. But the Christian now, on top of that, is given spiritual gifts and abilities to function for the profit of the body of Christ. For the profit of the body of Christ. To glorify God in all things. So, my question to you this morning, think about the substance of your talent. We know the source comes from God, but what is the substance of it? Now, all of you have natural abilities. Do you know what they are? Some of you can sing, some of you can teach, some of you can play music, some of you are great with cars, some of you are great with computers, some of you are great with so many things that God has given to you. You know who you are. You're good with construction, you're good with math, you're good with science, you're good as a nurse, you're good with health. You got all of that going for you. You know God gave that to you. But on top of that, as a Christian, what has God given to you? Some of you can teach. Some of you can minister. Some of you have discernment and wisdom. God's given all of that. And do you get it this morning, guys? God is the one that gave it all. He owns it all. And he goes away and he says, okay, I need my stewards to come here. And he gives one five and he gives the other two and gives the other one. What he says, according to the several ability, I've given you the ability to do this. Now do it. I've given you the ability to do that. Now you can't do as much as that guy, but you can do that. Now you do that. And you guess what? I've given you ability. It may not be as much as these guys, but I've given you ability. You all have an ability. I don't care if your IQ is five. You have an ability. You know, thinking about those that do not have necessarily the mentality or the ability to do many things, it's amazing how I have met people in ministry over the years. Although they may not have a lot of mental capacity, they have a heart for God, and they can sow. And they may not be able to do anything else. They can't teach. They can't sing. They can't go soul winning. They can't even get out of their house because they're invalid. But you know what? They can sow. And they give that to God. They give that to people. God says, according to your ability, well done. Well done. Just like Jesus said about the treasury when they were throwing the gifts to the treasury and all the wealthy people were throwing in all this money and the little old lady came walking up and just gave one little mite. And Jesus said, she has given more than all of them. And they said, what? And he says, because she gave all that she had. And they gave out of their abundance. No big deal for them. See, some that have great abilities and talents, we walk around puffed up like, well, I can do that. I can do that. I can handle that program because I've got that ability. I got that. Yeah, you can. It's pride. Be careful. Someone else who is offered a teaching position or a ministry, they get on their face before God and say, God, I can't do it. Please help me. And God gives them extra ability to do that. You know, when God sees that, who's God going to reward? You know, he's going to bless the one that's humbly using whatever God's given to him, and maybe not even enough, and God gives him more as he serves him. So the question is, what is the substance of your talent? What do you have that's natural ability, and what do you have that's God-given ability spiritually for his church? And then thirdly, the stewardship of our talent. So we saw the source, we see the substance, now the stewardship of our talent really is the whole message, right? That's really what this is about. If God is the source and the giver of all of our abilities, if God is the source and the giver of all of our abilities, then it would be wrong. As I manage his stuff, it'd be wrong to use his abilities for myself. You get that? Let me say that again. If God is the one that's given me all the abilities and the talents and the natural ability and spiritual gifts, to use that for myself would be wrong. Let me tell you, you know, what the Lord's convicted me of a long time ago. Whenever I play my trumpet all the time. And when I was in school, I started playing the trumpet when I was in fourth grade. And I just picked up on it pretty quick. And then as I started to play and I was in band and all this stuff in high school and all of that, there was a lot of competition. We went to state band competitions. I was in a jazz band at one time. I know it's hard to believe, but I did have a fro. I had an afro one time, and I played my trumpet. I was a solo trumpet player. I have pictures of me standing in front of all these people playing my trumpet and spotlight on me. I'm not kidding. I think, really? Yeah, it was there. Went to state competitions. I was booking for a scholarship to Illinois State on trumpet to play and just go on, be a musician. I wanted to be Maynard Ferguson. You don't even know who that is probably, but I wanted to be Maynard Ferguson. I mean, have my own band behind me. I mean, Tonight Show, Johnny Carson. I mean, that was what I wanted to do. I wasn't good enough for one, but I was very, very talented. And then God worked in my heart and said, I want you to go to Pensacola Christian College. So I came out of Pensacola Christian College as a just whatever God wanted me to do. I started off as a missionary aviation pilot. Then I went to computer science. Then I went to music. And finally figured out, okay, I need to be a Bible major. God said, I want you to be a preacher. Well, I remember the first semester I was there, I had my trumpet. And I would go down to the practice rooms, and I would play jazz band music. I mean, I just playing along, having a great old time. And then someone came knocking on my door at the practice room and said, hey, what are you doing in there? And they said, you can't play that kind of music here at Pensacola Christian College. I said, what kind of music? I wasn't sure. I was playing jazz music, stuff like that. And they said, no, you can't do that. And the Lord really spoke to my heart about that. And I started realizing all this talent that God has given to me, what am I using it for? To make money for myself, to make a name for myself? That was what I was going to do. And it came time where I finally said, you know what, I'm done. And I actually put my trumpet up. I put my trumpet up and didn't play it. I wasn't going to play it for a while because it was too much in my head about me. And then the Lord spoke to my heart and said, listen, I gave you that talent. I gave you that ability. Now, don't hide it. Use it for me. Use it for me. And so I started using my trumpet for the Lord at the school and so forth. And now I try to, and again, as a pastor, I didn't play for many, many years. And finally I said, you know what? I know I'm the only instrument up here. We got a whole orchestra up here and there's only one guy. But I'll use it for the Lord. How many of you have talents like that? Are you using it for God? He owns everything. And a long time ago, I told the Lord this. I said, God, you own me. You bought me. You own me. I've given my life to you, so all of my time is your time you've given me to manage. All of the talents that I have, if I have any, it's all yours you've given to me, and I manage it for you. So I'm going to use my trumpet for you, whether I'm good or not. I actually play a banjo and a guitar. I can do that. I use that for the Lord, too, from time to time, when I can. But again, when I hang it up and I see that banjo sitting over there, or that the other instrument sitting over there, I say, you know, I'm not going to play that. Then I get in back of my mind, God says, but you can play that, and you can sing a song for me with that. Okay. God keeps reminding me, this is what you've given to me. I manage this. Now, here it is. I manage your gifts, right? Every man received the gift, even so minister the same one another as a good steward of the manifold grace. God has given me grace. He's given me things to manage my time and my talents. Now, guys, listen. I know I'm beating this again and again, but you all have talents. You all have abilities. Now use it for God. Whatever it is, the abilities that you have, use it for God, not just for yourself. Use it for God, okay? So this is the stewardship. It's wrong for you to use your ability and gifts for your own benefit. And the goal that we have, now look back at verse 11. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth. Now here is the goal, that God in all things may be glorified. That God would be glorified. It's not about you, Joe. It's not about you, Titus. It's not about you, Lewis. It's not about whoever you are. All the stuff that you can do, it's all about God's glory. He gave it to you to manage it for Him. So it's wrong if I do it for myself. So think about that. What are you doing with the abilities God's given to you? So I can make money. No, to glorify God. That's the first thing. So that I could glorify God in all things, all things. But then secondly, the goal, not only to glorify God, but to profit the church. Look up here. Every man has received the gift, even so minister the same where? Everybody say, one to another. That's why. The reason why God gave you the gifts and the way we manage it is so that we can glorify Him with it and then minister to each other. Isn't that really kind of the Ten Commandments? Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Do it for God's glory and minister to other people. Same thing. Same thing. So your abilities. I was thinking the Lord for the way God has used some of you around here. These projectors and all of that. Who knows how to do all that? And some of you have the ability to put all that together. God has just shown you how to do that. Praise God, using it for the Lord, glory of the Lord. Building things around here. God's using you. Well, I'm not a teacher. I'm not a preacher. Yeah, but look what you did. Look what you're doing for the Lord. God is using you to do that. You're using your talents, your abilities for God. Cooking, working in the kitchen, helping us with our children's on the bus ministry, or having lunch for the kids, all for the glory of God. See, praise God for you. Praise the Lord. You're being a good steward, faithful and good steward of the things that God has given to you. Okay? 1 Corinthians 12:7 says, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit everybody with all. So He's given you the manifestation of spiritual gifts so it's a profit for the whole church. Isn't that cool? The stewardship of time. So as we close, what are you doing with the ability that God has bestowed upon you? What are you doing with it? We do three things. One, some people just simply let the abilities fade away. Well, I could play that when I was a kid. I used to do that a long time ago. You let it fade away. God gave you something, you let it go. Number two, we hide our abilities. We're embarrassed to use them. We're selfish. Well, I don't have time to practice like I need to, or I just don't have the ability anymore, and I don't want anybody to know I can do that. You know, I just don't want anyone to know at all. It's like the doctor who takes the position as a cook in a restaurant and doesn't want anybody to know he's a doctor and can actually help the person that's choking out there but walks away because he doesn't want to get involved. He's hiding the abilities God's given. So you don't play the piano, you don't sing, you don't use your instrument, you don't teach, you don't help because you hide your abilities. Who is the faithful and wise steward? Who will use their gifts for God? And then thirdly, some of you are simply afraid. Well, I don't know, I'm just not good enough. I know I got the ability, but I just don't want to, I just can't do it. Just remember, God gave that to you for a purpose. He is the faithful householder. He's the one that said, I will give you these talents according to your several ability. I have given you certain things because I know exactly what I've given you. I've given you an ability, and I will give you the grace to do it. To do it. Are you doing it? They're not yours. They're God's. Now manage them for him. Amen. Let's all stand, shall we? I don't know how this message is going to hit you, but when I look at that, I'm thinking, man, I just want to be a good steward. I want to be a good and faithful and wise steward of my time and my talents. How many of you want to be a faithful and wise steward of your talents? Raise your hand. You got talents, don't you? You got abilities. Let's use them for God. Let's use them for God, okay? Let's pray, and then as we do, we're going to sing one more song. Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you for the abilities you've given to us. Lord, and we know that some are given great ability, and some are just given a little ability. But whoever and whatever abilities we have, Lord, you expect us to use them for you as the source of all of our abilities and talents. Be faithful and wise steward. So bless us, Lord, as we serve you. These, my dear friends, God, everybody is so wonderfully gifted in some way. Now use us for you. God, I pray for the salvation of every soul, that they might know who you are in a real way and understand your love for them. Bless us now, Lord. We're about to have our fellowship time and food. We pray that you bless it to our bodies. Thank you for what you're going to give to us this afternoon in our study on prayer. It's going to be a great study. And Lord, I pray you just help us have a good afternoon. Thank you again for making all this possible for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before you take off, let's sing this one last song, Walk Worthy of the Lord. Debbie, can you play that? Okay, intro. It's kind of our benediction song. I want you to learn this. Ready?
Walk worthy of the Lord.
Dismissed. God bless you.